Hey, horse people. Mr. T's like, oh shit, he's got that damn camera out. Poor Mr. T. Where's mean old buddy boy? He's in trouble. He's out there pouting. He tried to sneak out when I brought Mr. T out. It's only taken me about 15 years to figure out when I do their feet, if I do them when they're by themselves, it's easier. It's easier for Mr. T because Buddy's not messing with him. But if I do Buddy by himself, he's wanting to get back out to Mr. T and pay attention to him, so that's kind of a pain too. But anyway, I'm just going to sit out here and do his feet and talk about whatever comes up. So Mr. T's usually pretty good about standing still unless I walk behind him with a camera. So we'll see if we can't get this set up for old Mr. T. But Mr. T's a good old boy. And I cut my damn hand all up with that rasp. I got a new rasp. And I usually don't use gloves, which I should. But I get lazy and confident, and I'll be careful, and I don't need it. And next thing you know, my hand's bleeding. So I am going to check out old Mr. T's feet, make sure I'm in screen here. I should have put fly spray on them. I didn't do that. All right, so let's see if old Mr. T's foot's going to be in this camera. I know, but come on. Oh, I kind of went a little forward. Now, Mr. T will probably hold his foot there for me because he's a good boy. Oh, maybe not. So I have to move that back just a little bit. It's hard to keep moving things. All right, give me this foot. I know. We in there? Yeah, I think we're in there. So I just figured I'd let you look at the foot before I even touched it. You can tell he's got a good chip here. He's been going out in the mud a lot. This is actually hoof wall right here. This isn't mud. And you're going to see a lot chip off. Big hunks. He develops a lot more hoof wall than Buddy does. And a lot of times I just chip off what I can. That's hoof wall. That's hoof wall. So, the longer I go, I went a little longer on this trim here than I should have because of rain or heat or whatever the excuse I'm using this week. This frog looks pretty good. Man, his feet are just freaking rocks. I can't believe how many people told me, you need to put shoes on him. Yeah, well, you're an idiot. So what I do when I can't chip them off is sometimes I just use the nippers and I bend it. And then that kind of scrapes off what I don't want. So I'm not really putting a lot of squeezing pressure. I'm just putting clamping and tearing. And there's probably some fairy out there that tells me what I'm doing wrong and why I shouldn't do this. So now that I've kind of cleaned this off, you can tell how long his hoof wall is and how long he is in a heel here. So I'm going to be taking off a good bit here. And again, I can use my knife a little bit. I don't sharpen it, so it's not really as sharp as it should be. And like I said, normally I don't mess with the sole. I'm doing this for you guys to see. A lot of times I just let it wear out by itself. The only thing I cut here is the bars. I don't want these bars right here in the middle. Man, he's got such hard feet. I don't know how those farriers keep their damn knives sharp. Woo! So I don't like his bars getting taller here, so I do like to trim those down.
And Mr. T's always gotten big bars, and they always tend to fold out on this side. Some people say that's confirmation, some people doesn't. I'm going to put his foot down for him. And hopefully he'll stand right there. He moved out of the foot so I could zoom in a little bit better. Because I don't know how much you guys are seeing. So now I'm going to try to get that, get some trimming done. Gave him a little break. Oh, what a good boy. I know. I know. And again, I usually put my knee right here to kind of trap that into this little stand here. And when you're first using nippers, a lot of people try to cut the full length of the nipper. I just try to cut half the nipper. That way it's not quite so hard. So it may look like I'm cutting full length, but I'm only moving half. And I'm so much damn slower. Farrier comes out here and knocks this out because he does it all the time in minutes to where it takes me a freaking half hour. Oh, and his feet are so hard. I mean, for somebody to think, yeah, I know what I need. This hoof is so hard, I'm going to put nails and a steel plate to help the horse. I'm like, really? All right. I know. He got tired. I usually, when he was younger, I wouldn't accept him pulling away like that. As he's gotten older, I realize that it probably hurts his foot. And he kind of gets tired of standing on 3 feet and needs a little break. So I cut him some slack when he pulls away from me now. But every time I cut him slack, I need to realize he's going to learn he can pull away. And it's okay to pull away. And he'll pull away more, thinking it's okay and that he can. So there's a fine line between letting him pull away all the time and sometime. Because I'm doing this video and yapping, I gotta cut him some more slack. I know. So I'm gonna put I got this new rasp, it sticks really bad, and I can only get short strokes because it's cutting so much. If I held his foot between my leg, I would have more torque and stabilization, and it would move around. But since it's not supported, you could tell his hoof wall here is very thick here, a little thinner here. I'm just going to try and get this kind of level right now. Almost as if I was putting a shoe on here because they flatten it out. And if you notice, I'm not getting a lot off this frog. Even though I'm rubbing this across, I'm not taking a lot off. So now what I need to do is trim this down. And some people will use nippers on this. Hang on. See, I didn't let him pull away that time. Good boy. And this will take it off quicker and put a little bit of an angle so I don't have to spend so much time with my nippers. And I'm going to let him rest. Because he's a good boy. And I'll show you a little bit of what I pulled off here. So this is part of the hoof. Notice how it's been smooth and rounded from him walking. Then that's where I cut it. Because it's flat and straight. This is part of a sole that was just chipping off. It's dried and thick. This gives them cushion. That's why I don't like to mess with the sole too much. Let me zoom out a little bit here. So I don't like to mess with the sole a whole bunch. And Mr. T's being a good boy. And hopefully you saw that hoof wall. He moved his foot a little bit, so I got to kind of guess on where I'm going to be here. I think I'm going to be about right there. I know. Come on. Don't be stubborn. Don't be a stubborn old Mr. T. So I'm just going to try and angle this wall almost to this white line that's dark there. I'm almost angling it here. And if you notice the angle of the rasp on the hoof, when I go on the top, it's going to be at the same angle. And I'm taking short, small strokes because my rasp is so sharp, it's sticking. Whereas if I was able to take long ones, I would get more off quicker. But fast isn't always the best. So I'm just going to whittle my way down. Now I could pay somebody to do this $50, and I actually called a farrier who does one of my neighbors and was going to have him do it, and he didn't call back. So now I'm either going to find somebody else, because I hate when people don't call back. So I think his name's Chuck, the farrier, lost me. All right. And I'm trying to get a uniform hoof wall around here. Tell us, a little thicker here, a little thinner here. Looks thinner, but it's because I put this angle on it. This is more flat. This is more of an angle. So it looks like it's thinner, but it actually isn't. I'm just taking down that overgrowth and rounding. This hoof wall back to put an angle, so when I do my Mustang roll, it's going to round out very nice. And this still really sticks out really far here, so I got to really bring this hoof wall down. I hope I'm in camera, because I didn't check. And so now you can tell the roundness coming around a little bit better. Flat, got an angle around here pretty nice. And now I'm pretty much done on the back side of this hoof. Now I'll do the top side. Oh, what a good boy. I know, poor old Mr. T. Dad, quit running your mouth and just do my damn hoof. So let's take a look at the front of the hoof now, and standing on the ground here. So as you can tell, that's just from a bottom trim. Nothing from the top. This is the untrimmed. See how he's chipping on his quarters? That's just from overgrowth. Mud, rain, weather, neglect. I haven't done his feet in a good, I'm going to say 6 weeks, if not 8 weeks. Like I said, I try to get out here like on the first of the month, around the first. That way I know he's getting it every 4 to 6 weeks. But sometimes because of weather or my back or laziness or whatever the excuse I want to use, I let him low grunt. Is this bad? Is this hoof like causing him pain? And it's just not as balanced as the other ones. It's not, he's not as level. Obviously, the one on the left looked like the horse is being cared for, and the one on the right looks like the horse is being neglected. So that's why a lot of times when I see horses, I look at their feet. Somebody may see this horse and go, damn, he's neglected. Well, I'm feeding him alfalfa hay, which is going to, you know, make his hooves go faster. He's running around on 10 acres of grass that he can eat all day, as much as he wants every day. He's older. I mean, his weight looks pretty good. 27-ish.
But he's showing signs of age with his teeth, his health, his immune system. He's not fighting off things. He's moving slower. There's all kinds of signs of age on him. So is it more critical to keep his feet better? Well, probably, but maybe his feet aren't as strong and they're chipping. He's got really hard feet. If I trimmed his feet every 2 weeks and just took a very little off, his hoofs would look really great. And again, that's just from the bottom. I always trim a hoof from the top and the bottom. I do my trimming and leveling off the bottom. Then on the top, I do my rounding and shaping. And again, that makes I forgot the scientific term, not a fulcrum. There's something that when you curve something or arch, an arch is stronger than a square because the arch puts pressure on itself. So when you're arching around on that hoof, it's the same principle. So let me see if I can get him, change my little thing, my little stand here. Because I'm only going to do one hoof, then I'll turn this off. Because doing all the hooves are just, I maybe should do a back hoof too. Again, when I put this down, I always put this away from the horse. So when he puts his hoof on here, if it slides back, I don't want him hitting this metal and chipping and tearing his foot and damaging the sole. So when I lift his foot up, this is always away. And I'm going to back him up just a little bit. Can we take a step back there, please, Mr. T? Thank you. You're such a good boy. Move those back feet, too. I know. Come this way. There you go. I know. He's a good boy. And I got to test his foot because he kind of comes to the inside. When I lift this, I really go inside on him. All right, so that's where he's going to put his foot. So now if I zoom in on that thing, you should be able to see what's going on. Good boy. Oh, what a good boy. All right. So now is when I come down at that same angle you saw me at the bottom when I was coming up. I was doing an angle like this. Now I'm going down almost on that same angle, but I'm doing it from the top. And then I'm looking right here. It's really long. You can't see that because you're not looking down. So I've got to take a little more off over here. And this RAS works much better because he's got his weight on it and his foot's not moving. Versus when it's bent like that, there's not a whole lot of support. So all I'm doing is what's called eyeing a nice round hoof. I'm going flat now because that's going to tell me if there's any ridges on the hoof. So I've got this flat against the hoof to pick up any uneven. I don't do a whole bunch. I'm not pressing hard. I'm just picking out, and you can tell where it cuts if there's a high end. You see I cut higher here than here, and it cut really low there even though I was flat. That means it's high here and it's high here. So that's all I'm kind of doing, is making the last quarter inch or so of the hoof as round and equal. Then I'm going to switch to the smoother side of the rasp and put that Mustang roll on that hoof all the way around. And I'm not taking a lot off. And let's see what that hoof looks like. Good old Mr. T being a good camera boy. All right. And now you kind of see what I call my finished hoof. And again, some people are going to say it looks like he's putting more pressure on front of it. You know, the mat that he's standing on isn't necessarily equal. Underneath the mat is not, it's not like flat concrete and then there's a flat mat on top. The ground has divots. When I spray this down water collects in the hole, so the mats aren't perfect. You can see the difference between a finished hoof and an unfinished hoof. Does Mr. T know the difference? I think he knows the difference now because one is lower and even and the other one isn't.
So if I left him like this, I think he would know the difference. But I think when both hoofs are the same, there's not a lot of difference to the horse. Unless they're starting to curl up and you have chips. I mean, if I had this kind of chips on the front and all over and they were working their way up the hoof, that would be a problem. But this flares on what they call the quarters, that's pretty common on any overgrowth of hoof. That's where it's going to snap the first. That's where you'll see the first part. That should be your first clue that your horse needs trim. When you see cracks or chips like that, and I call that a chip because that hoof has flared out because it got long, and because it flared, it put more weight on it and it just snapped off and chipped off. And that's what flares do. Right here where you see the scrape marks there was a little flare because when I put the ras flat, it cut there. Yet it didn't cut anything very high here. It made a couple little scrapes right there. But it did go higher here. So there was a little bit of flare of the hoof. When I say flare, it's kind of like an unequal part of the hoof. So again, I like my horse's feet, obviously, to look like this all the time. I mean, shit, if I had a full-time farrier here, I'd have them done every 2 or 3 weeks. I was made of money and didn't care. And would that really change anything? No, it'd make me feel better. Does this make me feel bad? A little bit. Like I kind of neglected and I waited too long and I don't like chips. But is this abuse or mean to a horse? I don't think a chip here and there is abuse. I mean, again, in police work we use the term totality of circumstances. Don't take each individual thing as something as gospel. You need to take totality of everything added together. So when I look at Mr. T, is he groomed well? Does he have food? Is he skinny? Is he fly ridden? Does he have scabs from weight? I mean, is he sick? Does he not see a vet? And then I see feet like this? Well, then that's totality. To me, the horse isn't cared for. Somebody's going to say, he's just offending his neglect because that horse is neglect. Whatever. I'm so tired of trying to do it. Idiots trying to nitpick stupid shit. All right, so not done hoof, done hoof. How long that take me? I don't know. I wasn't timing. Let's take a look at the back feet here because I'm going to do them. So what do we have here? What I want people to really notice is on the front of that hoof, you see how it's kind of shiny and smooth, almost like a roll? That's a natural sculpting that wild horses get when they're walking through rocks and weeds and long grass. Miles and miles of grass rubbing just finds and smooths out the edge of the hoof. And that's what they call a natural sculpted hoof. A hoof that doesn't get hoof work, but it looks like this in the wild. Now tomorrow, those scrape marks will be shiny and smooth because Mr. T's going to be walking all day and all night. And the grass is going to polish that hoof. And you won't see the discoloration where I just cleaned. It'll look like that all the way around the hoof, without the ragged edge or the chipped edge. And so when I do the back feet, same thing. But it usually happens on the toe is where you'll see most natural sculpting because horses are either overweight, not worked, dragging their feet. Some people will blame the horse for being lazy. What happened, Mr. T? I shook a damn fly by my head and waved my hand and he caught it out of the corner of his eye and jumped. Look at that head. See that kind of... Oh shit, what happened? All I did was, I'm going to move my hand like I'm chasing a fly. See, he didn't do it that time. But the first time he caught it, he was relaxing and he caught it outside his eye and he spooked a little bit. Not a big deal. Alright. Undone hoof. Undone hoof. See, he's probably, I would say he's just about ready to crack there on that quarter. See that little chip right there? If I let this continue to grow out, he will get the same crack on the rear as he does on the front. Remember, a horse carries like, what is it, 70-80% of his weight on the front hoofs. So front hoofs are much more critical than rear hoofs. I know somebody's going to say, that's not true, all hoofs are queet when they carry all the... Well, yeah, but in the spectrum of things, their front hoofs pull when they run, take off. They carry most of the weight, the shoulders, the head, most of the weight. When they're stopping and turning, their weight shifts to the front. The rear end does not usually carry a whole bunch of weight unless they're stacked down. So the rear hooves, if you notice, tend to be more what I call vertical,
up and down, boxy, and a front hoof looks more at an angle. And there's still people that tell me I need to take more toe off. I just don't like getting too close to that bulb. The bulb is the rear part of the foot, right where the hoof kind of comes out of the hoof. And if you get too close, you can make them bleed and you can damage, kind of like a toenail. If you cut the cuticle or you damage the cuticle, it'll take forever for that nail to fix itself. And then the black has to come all the way from the back of the nail. Well, if you look at the coronet band or coronary band, where the fur line is on the horse's hoof, that's like the cuticle. And the bulb is like the rear part of the hoof cuticle. So if you cut or hurt that bulb, it sometimes deforms the hoof that grows out of it. Just like if a horse gets an injury or a bang or cut on his coronary, his hoof will grow out, deform sometime, and it will take time for it to clear. Looking at that hoof over there, it almost looks like he's got a little bit of a muscle right there. Because he walks kind of pigeon-toed. That's more on the inside of his foot. And that's just how he walks. Some people will call it swing-footed. Some people think it's cool because he whips his feet out in like circles, and Clydesdales and stuff do that, or draft horses do that. Well, he walks on the inside of his hooves, and that's why it's polished more on the inside front, and it's worn out more. So, this is just a little hoof 101, and again, I call this developing your critical eye. Again, when I see a horse, 9 times out of 10, I immediately go to their feet. And I don't go to it to say whether the horse is bad or good. I go to it to look at how the hoof is wearing, how the horse is walking. Can I tell if they're done, taken care of? Can I tell if the horse favors one side or the other? Does the hoof have polish? I mean, if Mr. T was walking by me with this hoof, I would automatically know that he's a little wing-footed and walks on the inside of his toe. Kind of like people who wear shoes out. You know, some people, you look at a shoe that's old, and the rear part of the right heel will be worn down, and the rest of the sole looks pretty good. Or the inside left part of the sole is worn down. Horses are the same way. People want to make hooves so complicated, and they really aren't. I mean, you can damage them if you do stupid stuff, but less is more. If you want to do your own horse's feet, I mean, I would highly recommend it. That way you can be responsible. You know, you can fix problems when they occur. If he does get a bad crack or if he does do something, I know I can go out there and take care of it, and I don't have to wait or depend on a farrier. And I don't have to pay a farrier to come out with an attitude and tell me that I don't know what I'm doing and just let him do his job and have him beat up on my horse and think, well, I guess that's normal. I'm not saying all farriers are bad. There's good farriers out there, but it's very easy because farriers have power over ignorant people in the horse world, and most people in the horse world are ignorant. Remember, like 90% of the people that own horses have owned them for less than a year or new horse owners. Very few people stay in horses for the long term. So that makes a market ripe for predators and people to know I'm dealing with idiots and they're going to be gone in a year anyway, and I'm going to have some new idiots. So there's really no reason to develop a good customer basis. Very few people I know have the same farrier over 4 or 5 years. They either move, new barns, farrier moves, farrier leave. I mean, I just don't know anybody who has a farrier for over 5 years. And because the horse turns over, they change markets, they find new ways, or they get out of the business, or they get old, or they get injured. So I really dislike farriers that come out and take advantage, especially women at barns, because they can. Because they know they're the tough guy, and they know that the person having the horse loves the horse, but they don't understand the horse, and they don't know how to work the horse, and they don't know how to teach the horse or train a horse. So the farrier comes out there, and in the land of the blind, the man with one eye is king. So when a farrier walks out to a barn full of one-year horse owners that don't know anything, he's in the land of the blind, and he's got one eye. So he runs around and tells everybody what they need to do and how they got to hit the horse, how they got to make the horse, and how you got to show the horse his boss, how you got to put a twitch on a horse and bend this horse's back. And if he moves, I need to hit him with the rass or knee him in the ribs or punch his teeth out. Did a video where the horse said this guy punched the teeth out on a horse. Dude, somebody come punch my horse in the mouth and break their teeth, they're leaving here spitting out chitlets, because I guarantee you they ain't leaving with teeth. I don't care what I got to do. But I digress. Don't want to make this a violent video. Poor Mr. T's like, damn, let's not get into knocking out teeth here. Poor old Mr. T. He's a good old boy. All right. Well, that's pretty much hooves 101. I like doing just simple videos on hooves to get people comfortable, because hooves are like the big mystery in horses. Oh, you got to get a farrier. Oh, you got to have shoes. Oh, you got to know, and hot shoes better than cold shoe, and nails and plastic shoes and pink shoes and wraparound shoes and glue shoes. And what about rubber shoes? And oh man, it just gets so, it's like crazy. But you know what? Knowledge is power. And if you don't want to get taken advantage of and you don't want to be treated like an idiot, then don't be an idiot. Rick, you can't call people idiots. Shut up, you big dummies. All right, we'll end that there. Buddy, you're a good boy, and so is Mr. T. Where's that crazy old buddy? I'll just go out there and beat him just for YouTube pleasures. He's eating. He don't care. All right, we'll end that there.